Hello everyone, I am MD Varshit Khan, your friend, philosopher and guide. Welcome back to WBCS for All. Today I am going to teach you the basics of Indian polity. It is one of the most important chapter for anyone who want to read polity and who want to prepare polity, especially for WBCS examination or any other examination, okay? There's a little bit details about me that I got rank 8 in CTU 2016. I am working as inspector BCW. And for more details, you can see on my Facebook, as well as you can join our WBCS channel, WBCS for All YouTube channel. There's a red button below this screen. You can just click on that so that whenever I will upload a new video, you will get the notification on that. Okay. Now let's begin with the basics of Indian polity. What is government? Listen, what happens before 200, 300 and 400 PS, the pattern of government is same all over the world. There was a king, he was the legislature, means he makes the rules, okay? He was the executive, means he execute the rules, and he was the judiciary. He also codified or decodified, or he also tell what is wrong or what is right. Means there was no need of the government. The king itself was the legislature, executive and judiciary, which are the three pillars of the government. Then how the beginning of government or democracy started? Sometimes press is also called as fourth pillar of government. It will mostly ask in competitive examination that press, which is the fourth pillar of the government. Okay, how the beginning of democracy in 1215 in England, what happened? There was a king known as John II. He imposed a taxes on the people of England. Then what happened? People of England protested and they revolted, but at the first time they won the war, but they didn't beheaded the king, they didn't kill the king, they didn't remove the king. They told the sir, you have all the power to impose taxes, you are my king, you have all the power to impose taxes, but after that you have to take permission of a council of minister chosen by people, and this thing were signed in a paper, in a charter, and that is known as Magna Carta. Okay, so whenever you listen the word Magna Carta means the first written document of anything. Remember, Wood Dispatch is called the Magna Carta of Indian education, because at that time education was given priority. So remember how the term Magna Carta will come then. Okay, and what happened in present day government? There are two type of head. The first one is head of state and the second one was the head of government. Head of states are those people on the name of which the treaties and everything are signed. For example, in case of England, the treaty is signed on the name of monarch, and in case of India, the treaty is signed on the name of president. But they are taking decisions. No, they are not taking decisions. Thus, they have only nominal head, so they are known as the head of the state. They don't have any real power. The second one is head of the government. They are those people, the name of which nothing happens, but they are doing all the activities, and they are the real head of government. In case of India and England, it is Prime Minister, and in USA it is President. Remember the presidential format of government, where there is no Prime Minister. President is the head of state, as well as President is the head of government. Apart from that, there are two type of you can say governments are found, or two types of constitution, or two types of countries are found. The first one is unitary and the second one is federal. Unitary form of government are though there was a single tier of government. There's only one national government, no regional government. That is called unitary government. And in federal government, there are two or more form of government. It is called as federal government. So India is a federal country and England is a unitary country. Okay. In Indian Federation, there is a three tier in India. Union government is state government and local bodies. But I will start with the local bodies. Local bodies are in two types. The first one is in the village, the second one is in the urban. In urban, we know there are municipalities, there are municipal corporation. In village, the power is divided in three levels: the block, village and district. In block, there is a village, block and district. In village, there is a pradhan. In block, there is a sabhapati, and in district, there is a jila parishad or jila adhyaksh. Now, in the union government consists of Lok Sabha and Raj Sabha. Lok Sabha is known as House of People, lower house or House of Common, and Raj Sabha is known as upper house, council of state or house of lords in case of you can say England. In a state government, there is a Vidhan Sabha, Vidhan Parishad. And in remember, it doesn't mean that every state has Vidhan Parishad. In India, it is left upon the state that which state want to create Vidhan Sabha and which state want to abolish Vidhan Parishad. Sorry, which state want to create Vidhan Parishad and which state want to abolish Vidhan Parishad. So we can see that in present time, there are seven states which have Vidhan Parishad. So how to remember that seven government? There's a trick known as Jhumbak. Remember Jhumbak. And they are the bigger states. J for Jammu and Kashmir, U for Uttar Pradesh, M for Maharashtra, B for Bihar, A for Andhra Pradesh undivided. Means after division it became Andhra and Telangana, two came from here, and after that Karnataka. In this way we can see that we have seven states where there is a Vidhan Parishad or Legislative Council. Now first of all we will difference between the parliamentary form of government and presidential form of government. Where what is parliamentary form of government? What is presidential form of government? Where the head of the government is prime minister. Head of government is prime minister. It is parliamentary. And where the head of the president is, head of government is president, it is presidential form of government. India and England are the typical example of parliamentary form of government, and USA is the typical example of presidential form of government. What are the features of parliamentary form of government? Dual executive, I told you, one is real executive and one is nominal executive. President is nominal executive in India and Pradhan Mantri or Prime Minister is the real executive. Majority party rules means it doesn't depend upon the person who rules. It depends on the party. The party who won the majority of the seats appoint someone to become Prime Minister. It is collective responsibility. It is called that the collective responsibility because in the parliamentary form of government, they are told that the Council of Ministers, the Prime Minister, they either swim together or sing together. Suppose Prime Minister resigns, means entire Council of Ministers resigns. Okay. There is political hegemony. Obviously, the party which will win more number of seats will have the political hegemony in the parliament. There is double membership. Obviously, there is double membership because those person who are the member of the legislature are also the member of the executive. For example, Pradhan Mantri or Prime Minister or the Council of Ministers, they are both. They are legislative, they are the part of legislature also, and they are part of the executive also. Leadership of the Prime Minister, here obviously Prime Minister leads a dissolution of the lower house. Here lower house dissolves, and as the lower house dissolves, there is elections, we know that, and there is fusion of power. There are more fusion of power. It means the executive and the legislature, they are interconnected. Okay, but what happened in presidential form? There is a single executive, that is the president. President is the real as well as the nominal executive. Are the president and kingship elected separately for a fixed term? Those who are the president, they are selected for the fixed term, 5 years. Means it does not depend upon the majority party rule. You have elected president, this president will stay there for 5 years. Okay, there is no responsibility, there is no collective responsibility. Individual is responsible for individual act. You can't blame the government, you can blame the minister. Okay, there is political hegemony, may or may not exist. Suppose Barack Obama won the presidential election, but in the election of Senate and in the election of their Lok Sabha, their party may lose, but it doesn't affect the position of the president. Okay, there is a single membership, that is the member of legislature and executive are separate. It does not depend in USA. It doesn't mean that those who are elected among them, the president have to choose the ministers. No, president can choose anyone as a minister. It is not necessarily that they have to choose the minister among the parliamentarians. So there is a single membership. There's a domination of president. Obviously president dominates, okay, because it is presidential form of government. There is no dissolution of lower house, and there's a separation of power, means the power of legislative and executive and are properly distributed, that they don't interfere in the power of each and others. So the what are the merits and demerits of presidential form of government? We can see here is the in the parliamentary form of government, the merit is the harmony between legislature and executive, because they both are of the same. There must be harmony, but in it is the demerit in presidential. There is a conflict between legislature and executive. So remember, what is a merit in a parliamentary form of government, the same thing is demerit in presidential form of government. Here is responsible government, because anytime they can lose the confidence of people and they can down. So they were very responsible. They try to bring policies for the welfare of the people. But here is non-responsible government. It doesn't depend on anyone. If you have to choose a president for the 5 years, means you have chosen. It prevent despotism, obviously, because they know that the people have elected them not for a particular terms. Because if suppose most of the people started revolting in a particular party, then the particular party may lose the confidence. So it never lead to despotism, but it may lead to autocracy in presidential form of government. Okay, here is wide representation, obviously, because people came from different sections in the parliament, and from them you have to choose the ministers. But here is no responsive. There is very narrow representation, because it depends upon the whims and fancies of the president whom to elect and whom to make prime ministers or whom to make ministers. Okay, demerits are, here is unstable government, obviously. If it is collective, then it is unstable. Here it is a stable government. There is no you can say there is no continuity in the policies, because again election is coming. This year election is coming, again another year election is coming. So they can't continue a definite policy. They are looking for the populist policies, okay? But there is definiteness in policy, because they know that they are chosen for a fixed term. They are against the separation of power, because the power are fused and interconnected. But here, the based on separation of power, the power of executive and legislature is properly demarcated. Here, what happens? Here is the government by immatures, because we have limited scope. Among those who are elected in the parliament, we have to choose them. But here is the government by expert. What happens? US president choose some retired army general as the defense minister, so that they have the experience. Some very big economist as the finance minister. But the same thing is not possible in parliamentary form of government. In this way, we can see that what is the difference between parliamentary and presidential form of government. Now what is the difference between federal and unity form of government? It is also a very important question. Sometimes it asks in examination. And even what is the federal government? Here is the dual government. Obviously, I told you federal means there will be a national government and regional government. Okay, the dual government, national and regional government. Here the single government, that is national government, which may create regional government. Here is a written constitution, because the power have to demarcate. You have to demarcate the power, na? What is the power between the state and what is the power between the center? That must be written. So we can see that in most of the federal countries, even all of the federal countries, there is a written constitution. But in unitary constitution may be written or unwritten. For example, written constitution in France and unwritten constitution in Britain. Okay, remember, in unitary form of government, they believe in the parliament. Parliamentary sovereignty means whatever parliament will decide, that will become the last thing. So the constitution is nothing, and the parliament every time act as a constituent assembly. But in a federal form of government, the constitution is supreme. It is once written, and judiciary has given the power that you have to interpret whether the rules are made within the purview of constitution or not. Okay, so there's a division of power between national and regional government. No division of power, all power are vested in this national government. Obviously, I told you, means there are in Indian constitution there are three lists: union list, state list, and concurrent list. Means the power is properly divided. Supremacy of constitution, as I told you, because the judiciary has given the power that you have checked whether the acts are made within the purview of the constitution or here constitution may be powers are vested in the here rigid constitution, because constitution is written, so it must be rigid so that the balance of power not be disturbed. Otherwise, what will happen? Union government will take all the powers. Here are independent judiciary, and it is given more power. In England, the judiciary are not that powerful. Why? Because the judiciary don't have the power to views in the constitutional matter. The parliament is head in the constitution, so they work on only the civil and the criminal matter. They doesn't look upon the constitutional matters. So judiciary is not powerful in unitary country, but it is very powerful in federal countries. And here is bicameral legislature, that is Lok Sabha and Raj Sabha. Okay, now come to the unitary form of government. No division of power, all power vested in national government. Constitution may be rigid, France, or flexible. Judiciary may be independent or may not be independent. Legislature may be bicameral like Britain and unicameral like China. So in this we have seen what are the federal countries and what are the unitary countries, what are their features. Okay, after that we will move that what is the constitution, what are the difference between written constitution and unwritten constitution. Remember that to one country in India, that is England, he told, I don't write any constitution because we are the most mature democracy in the world. Whatever we are telling, that becomes a constitution for other countries. So we need not need to codify anything. Our parliament is mature enough that we will write any constitution. We don't need to write any constitution. So all the countries have written constitution except England, because England, I told you the reason, New Zealand told, I am following England, so I don't need to make a constitution. And Israel, the three countries in the world don't have written constitution. But in unwritten constitution, England, New Zealand and Israel have unwritten constitution. Here constitution is supreme, so it is codified, and judiciary has more power because it is interpreted. The rules and regulation are made, or the acts are made within the purview of judiciary, means constitution not. But here parliament is supreme, so here the concept of parliamentary sovereignty means parliament is sovereign. Here less power to judiciary. Okay, now what are the features of Indian constitution? It is very important chapter. Means I have summarized the three chapter of Lakshmikant within this 15 to 17 minute video. Okay, what are the features of Indian constitution? It is the lengthiest written constitution of the world. Here when it was made, there are 395 articles, but right now it become 450. Whenever, but the last number is still 395. Whenever a new article is made, it has given the number capital A or capital B. Suppose we have to insert a number between 4 and 5, so it becomes 4A. Okay, earlier it was 395, but right now it becomes 480, 450 articles. Earlier there were 8 parts in the constitution, but right now there is 12 parts in the constitution. Earlier there were 8 schedules in the constitution, right, it becomes 12. Earlier there were 22 parts in the constitution, right, it becomes 25 parts, but again last number is again 22. So it is drawn from various sources. Like, it's the most important of the sources is the Government of Indian Act 1935. Okay, and it is a blend of rigidity and flexibility. I mean, some provisions of the constitution is very rigid, like you can say where we can take power, or where we are disturbing the balance of the power or separation of power, it becomes very difficult. You have to take 2-3 majority of parliament. Apart from that, you have to ratify half of the state. But it is flexible in normal cases. So it is a blend of rigidity and flexibility. We have seen that India is a federal country, but unitary biases. In emergency, it becomes unitary, and the more power has given to the union government. So definitely it is a federal country, but the unitary bias is there. It is parliamentary form of government, we all know, but we have taken this government from England. It is synthesis of parliament sovereignty. We have taken parliamentary form of government. In the parliamentary form of government on Britain, parliament is sovereign. I told you, now the parliament can make any law, but here is the concept of judicial supremacy from US is taken. All the parliament is supreme, but constitution is written, so you have to work within the purview of the constitution. So it is a unique mixture of parliament sovereignty and judicial supremacy. Here there are integrated and independent judiciary. Integrated means whatever provisions are given to the high courts and lower courts, the same provision will be applicable to Supreme Court. So if the Guwahati High Court is given a verdict, it means it is a verdict given by Supreme Court of India, until Supreme Court of India doesn't nullify it. So means a judgment is given in Guwahati is also given in Kolkata. And independent means the judiciary is given the power, flexibility to draw them regarding their salaries, regarding their appointments, regarding their selection, so that the judiciary does not become politicized. Okay, fundamental rights are given. Obviously we will make a video on that. DPSP dietary principles are given, definitely make a video on that. Fundamental duties are given, definitely make a video on that. And India is a secular state, although it is explicitly mentioned in the preamble of the constitution and implicitly mentioned in the article 25 to 28 and DPSP that India is a secular state. It does not recognize any religious or official religion, but it try to promote all the religions of the country. Even we give a subsidy for Hajj also, and we give subsidy for Amarnath Yatra also. But in Western countries, secularism means totally separation of church from government. And here universal adult franchise means every citizen who is of 18 year of age has given the power, until and unless he is not mad or there are some irons regarding that. So universal means everyone is applicable, adult means more than 18, and franchise means voting power. There is a single citizenship. India is a federal country, but unlike USA where there is a dual citizen, that is state citizen are federal citizen. In India, is a single citizen, and every citizen is free to go any part of the country, reside, settle, do any of the business or any of the activity. So we have only one citizenship, that is Indian citizenship. There are independent bodies. Obviously, independent bodies are given to maintain the true character of the constitution, like UPSC, like Election Commission, like CAG. Okay, so these are they are wheels of our constitution. Emergency provision, it is unique in India that there is emergency provisions, three type of emergency: national emergency, state emergency, and financial emergency. And the three tier government, I told you, India is a federal country with three tier of government. In this way, my friend, I can say that I have completed the entire chapter 3 of the Indian constitution and the basics of Indian constitution, and I have summarized all this thing within 20 minutes. Thank you very much for the video. Do share and promote, give your opinion in the comment box. Thank you very much.